pray eternal Father, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Lord, we come this morning thanking you first of all for allowing us to see a day that one promised us. Lord, as we gather in your house today, Lord, we ask you to allow your Holy Spirit to be among us. Then, Father, we ask you to your will that you would continue to bless our pastor as he's back there meditating on the word to bring forth us. We pray, Lord, that everything today will go pleasing in your sight. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God. You may be seated.
Let's all say amen. Amen again. We are going to go ahead and read a scripture this morning and get ready to go high in our service. First Peter, the second Peter is what I'm going to read. Second Peter 2. Beginning at the 20th verse says, "For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness, and after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to a wallowing in the mire." May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy.
Guide me, oh, I'm great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Guide me, oh, no more.
Heavenly Father, we come thanking you this morning for another day's journey, Lord. Realizing that it was no goodness of ours that you brought us to this place, but it was your grace and your mercy. Father, realizing that we have all sinned and come short of your glory. But Father, we ask right now in the name of Jesus, please forgive us. Father, we ask that you would forgive us of all of our sins.
Oh, yes.
And Father, we pray right now that you would send your Holy Spirit to come into this place, reign and rule over us right now.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
All those that are not on one accord this morning, Father, we pray that you would touch them right now.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Father,
we declare that your Holy Spirit is the only thing that can rule in this place this morning.
Yes,
no demons, no witches, no wild things can come in this place this morning. Nothing but your Holy Spirit.
Yes,
touch each every man, woman, boy, and girl this morning.
Yes,
that they may feel your presence and your power this morning, Lord. Father, we need it right now.
Yes,
we need you to look into our world this morning, Father. Knowing that you are God and you're still in control, and that whatever we have need of, you can and will do it for us. If it be your will, Lord, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we ask that you would touch those who are sick and shuddering this morning.
Yes, Lord.
Those all over the land and see who have lost a loved one and are crying in the middle of the night for strength, Father. We ask that you would touch them right now.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, Father, we pray for our pastor this morning.
Yes, Lord.
That you would hold him up and be his leading voice,
Father. Yes, Lord. Yes,
Lord. Bless Sister Lewis as well, Father, that she will be the helpmeet that he still needs, Father.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Oh, Father, we pray right now for this pulpit.
Yes, Lord.
We pray for the deacon boy. We pray for the usher boy.
Yes, Lord.
We pray for our choir that they will sing Zion songs this morning.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Oh, Father, our musicians.
Yes, Lord.
Give them that power to play this morning, Father. That their angels may rejoice.
Yes, Lord.
And that our members, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Help them right now.
Yes, Lord.
To lift and praise your holy name.
Yes, Lord.
And Father, we'll always be mindful to give you all praises, honor, and glory.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name we ask it all. Amen. And thank God.
You're the one, you're the only one. you don't have to worry, then don't you be afraid. Joy comes in the morning, then troubles don't last always. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. With him I know I can take it. With him I know I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. Why?
Don't you be afraid.
The joy comes in the
morning.
The troubles that don't last
always.
There's a friend in Jesus. Who will wipe every tear away. If your heart is broken. Lift your hands and say,
I know that I can make it.
I know that I can stand.
I know that I can stand.
No matter what,
my life is
here. Say, I know. With him, I know I can.
No matter what,
my life is. Listen. So when your tests and trials may seem to get you down, you look for your friends and loved ones, but they cannot be found. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, come on, I know I can.
I know that I can stand.
I know that I can stand.
No matter what,
my life is
in
you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
give you all.
Amen. Let's just say amen.
forgive us of our sins. And then, God, we ask that you will have mercy upon each and every one of us. We pray, God, that you touch our hearts in a mighty special way. Oh, God, sometimes we don't do things which we should always do, but have mercy upon us. And sometimes, God, we don't go to the places that we go to places that we should not be going, and we ask that you would have mercy upon us. And then, God, sometimes we say things that we should not be saying, but have mercy upon each and every one of us. Because we realize, God, when we were nothing, you made us be something. When we didn't have anything to do or nothing to do, you helped us and you made a way for us. And we want to say thank you. Thank you for your goodness. And thank you for your mercy. We want to praise your holy divine name. And we didn't have nothing to say. We just want to say thank you for being so good to us. You put food on our table. You put clothes on our backs. And God, you went with us when we went up and down the dangerous highways and byways. And we want to say thank you. Oh, God, and we can't say thank you enough. For some of us, we've been in the hospital, and you were sitting there with us. And we want to say thank you. When the tears came rolling down our weeping eyes, God, you wiped them. And we want to say thank you. Oh, thank you. When we lost our loved ones, you was right with us. We want to say thank you. Oh, thank you. When the doctors went coming inside of us, open our bodies up and heal our body, we want to say thank you. Oh, thank you. You've been good to us. This church, these members, we pray, God, if you just bless us in a mighty special way. Some have been laying in the hospital. Some have been sick. And you bless them. You bless them to be able to come to be with us one more time. And we want to say thank you. And then, Sister Delaney, we pray and we pray. When she goes to the doctor for surgery, we know, God, that you already died. We know, God, that you was already there before they even told her that they were going to do surgery on. So we pray and we pray. And we know that man makes mistakes. But you are God that never make a mistake. Touch the doctors in a mighty special way. Touch the nurses in a mighty special way. And then bless her family. Let them know, God, that you are with them. Have mercy upon them. We thank you. This church, sometimes, God, we get off track. Sometimes, God, we don't do all the things that we should be doing. But God, I want to look at myself first. And I ask that you will have mercy upon me. I ask, God, that you give me strength to do things which is pleasing to your sight. Not nobody else's sight, but your sight. And I know, God, that when we walk right, and I know, God, that when we talk right, and I know, God, that when we try to live right, that you will have mercy upon us. And you will be with us. And when we get a little weak, we pray, God, that you just lift us up. Hold us, Master. Be with us, Master. And God, we mold you. We recognize you. And we thank you. And God, I just want to say thank you. And God, I ask in the name of Jesus that you allow the Holy Spirit to take control of our minds in the name of Jesus. And I ask if it be according to your will that we would all lift up our hands and just praise your Holy Spirit. holy divine name. Give you the praise, everybody in the church. Lift up your hands and give God the praise. Because he's worthy to be praised. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Thank you, God. And we love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. And thank you, God. Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And thank you, God. Sister Lauren's daughter, we're glad to see you. Amen.
Amen.
Sister Lauren has been a blessing to all of us.
Amen.
Amen. We do some things that some of us forget to do sometimes. Amen. Six, she gonna always be calling them and talking to them on the phone. Sometimes I talk to Sister Lauren, I say, how my little daughter's doing? Amen. And I thank God for them. Amen. They're part of Sister. Hebrews 10 and verses 24 and 25. The Hebrews 10 verses 24 and 25. There is a word from God.
Amen.
And in the 24th verse, it says, and let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works.
Amen.
Y'all see that?
Amen.
And then the next verse said, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the matter of some is. But what? Exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching.
Amen.
Amen. Let me tie to this. Excuse me. Your butts in the way. Excuse me. Your butts are in the way. Thank you, ushers. I want to lift as a thought this morning, excuse me, your butts, B-U-T, possibly S, in the way. Let's keep it right. You see, we all have them. They are usually pretty big. Though some may be bigger than most, but we all have them. Are you with me, church? Some are so big that others try to hide behind them. Are you with me, church? Some of us use them more than others. I'm talking about the B-U-T apostrophe S. However, the butts, they seem to end up getting in our way. But I can't. But I'm over 50. But I don't have any money. But I'm in bad health. But I've been through so much. But I don't have anything to put in church. And when we sit back and think about the butts, oh, what big butts we have. Notice I started out with but I. Let me share something with you. Everybody we know, you got to be real on this message. Everybody we know has a big butt. And more often than not, it's the one thing that keeps us from living a consistent life for Jesus. Let me work with that a few minutes. See, if you can recognize any of those buts, but I have to work more. But my kids have to practice. But it's such a beautiful day. But I'm just not in the mood. But I deserve a break for today. Holy, Holy Spirit. Every kind of butt interferes with my life of just living a reliable life for God. Are you with me? And more often than not, it always have something to do with some sort of the truth is that even the smallest but can interfere with our relationship with God. You see, it really can, my brothers and sisters. It can distract me and even get me to think I'm not going to pray today. I'm not going to think about it today. I'm not going to deny myself. And I'm not going to read the Bible. And the list can go on and on and on. And whatever it is God asks me to do, it seems like, my brothers and sisters, that the butt always gets in the way. And the biggest bug of all times is the bug that keeps, that gets in the way of me just hanging out with God and reading his word. It's true. If you sit back and think about it, my brothers and sisters, you see, just try reading your Bible. Reading your Bible, let's say Saturday night, for Sunday school, Sunday morning. And soon as you start reading your Bible, the big book will show up and stop you from reading your Bible. Am I right about it? You see, sometimes when you start reading your Bible, you get tired. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Then you got your cell phone, and then it start going off, and then you end up getting on Facebook. The game is going on, and Cowboys that came up, and you start watching the game. The origin of every excuse is the failure. I told y'all this one other time. The football coach at Jackson State University and the former outfielder of the Atlanta Braves and the quarterback of the Atlanta Falcons, he practiced. He stayed in practice. He had other kids with him, and they also practiced too. But they would get into the streets. And Deion Sanders, he just kept on going to school. He was trying to get himself in conditions. And he made a success of himself. And he began to explain this. He said, I call them IDA. If I'd have done this, I'd be making $3 million today. If I'd have practiced a little harder, I'd have been a superstar. You see, he got to saying, they was fast as me, but they was kids. But instead of them keep on doing what they were supposed to be doing, they got off track.
Yeah.
He said, when I was young, I had practiced my friend who didn't went straight to the streets and never left. I said that to say this. We don't need no more eyes. Because we see the day is approaching. Are y'all with me, church? And you see, I come to tell us this morning, sometimes we let our butts get in the way. A church, Gore wrote a letter. And when he wrote this letter to the editor of the newspaper, he complained. And it made no sense to go to church. Y'all got to stay with me. He said, I've been going to church for over 30 years. He said, I had heard over 3,000 sermons. But for the life of me, I can't remember a single one of them. But he got to thank it. He said, I think the pastor is wasting his time by giving us all these sermons. And he said, when he wrote this letter, it started a controversy in the letters to the editor. To the editor, it went for weeks until somebody wrote back. They wrote back and they told him, I've been married. And I've been married for 30 years. And my wife used to cook meals each and every day. If my wife had to cook these meals for me, I would have laid there and I would have died physically. But he went on to say this. But one thing that I do know, that the food that she cooked, it nourished my body. Are you with me, church? It gave me the strength that I needed. And then he went on to say, going to church is a nourishment.
Amen.
In other words, he said, I would have been spiritually dead if I didn't go to church. And oftentimes, we simply look for excuses not to attend church or church activities throughout the week. Some of us, we slip. I'm just being honest. We slip. It hurts. It hurt me when I don't do what I should be doing. And sometimes I find myself not doing what God wants us to do. And you see, sometimes we don't like the truth because sometimes the truth, it shames us. It makes us look bad. It makes us feel bad. But we need to stay in God's word for the nourishment.
Amen.
Turn your Bibles real fast to 2 Timothy. When you get there, look at 2 Timothy 4 and 2. We there? If you look at that verse, it said, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrines. Now look at verse 3. It says, for this time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Some folks don't want sound doctrine. It don't make no difference what you say. If they don't want it in their minds and heart, then you can say what all you want to. You can get preachers coming here and they can get everybody up jumping around and doing everything and going on and people leave here and they go and still do the same thing that they've been doing. why? Because they're after their own lust. Shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears? Ain't it strange how we get on the phone and talk about what the preacher said or what the teacher said? And we don't want to do nothing they say. Itching ears. You see how I found out what can happen to us if we get too busy. We get too busy. We get too busy with our families. Are you with me, church? We are supposed to love our family, but sometimes we get too busy with our families and we put God on the back burner. We get so busy with our friends. We get so busy with our work. We get so busy with cleaning. We get so busy with cooking. We get so busy with our vacation. And we get so busy sleeping. In other words, we are just busy. We are just too busy to bother God. We're too busy to be faithful in church, but yet and still we talk about what God has done for me. We are too busy to bother with the ministry of the church. The only time that we ask God for something is when we want something. We don't want to do nothing he tells us to do. We only ask him for something when we want something.
Amen.
Can I preach this thing? What if God would do with us the same way?
Yeah.
What if he woke up one day and said, I'm tired of it all.
Yeah.
And I want to do something else. And then he left us on our own. Where would you get money from if you ran out of money? Y'all know church folks. When you come to the church asking them for this, where would you get money if God wasn't putting it in your pocket? If he didn't open up the hearts of somebody else and told them to help Lewis out, Lewis needs some help. What if you find yourself in a desperate situation and needed the Lord's comfort? We'll quit to say he better comfort himself. Listen to me, please. We can't do God on our own terms and expect to come out on top. It's not gonna work. We must stop making excuses, and I'm talking about all of us.
All right.
I start right here in the pulpit. We continue that lie by saying we are only humans. And then we stick with this trump card. And we believe that since we are fleshly creatures, we are expected to fail. That it's okay for us to be less than we should be. We believe it's okay when we fail because he understands that we are truly human. Who made us? We set ourselves to fail before we even try. This getting tough. Let me tell you why. Moses did the same thing when God spoke to him through the burning bush. God told Moses over in Exodus 3:10, so now go. He said, I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt.
Yeah.
But if you notice when you read that, Moses had a lot of books. But who am I that I should go? But what if they don't believe me? But what if they don't listen to me? You see, Moses didn't want to leave his comfort zone. Sometimes we call ourselves Christians, but we don't want to leave our comfort zone. He was content to what he had. And sometimes when God bless us and give us a home, when he give us a car, I say this all the time, we used not to have one car. But now we got two or three. And we be comfortable then. You know, I said this one other time. That sometimes let us get us a new car. We'll miss church two or three Sundays in a row. And we go around telling everybody how good God is.
The password is security. Well, is the password supposed to be the security?
God does not call us to be people of comfort. When God calls us, he calls us to be people of action.
It's all listening. Because he asked me to add.
He don't want no excuses. He want our hearts. And then when you keep on reading about Moses, you find out that God got angry. He got upset with Moses. Can I tell us something? Same with us. Same with us. And then sometimes we can't figure it out. We can't figure it all out. But sometimes God's been upset with us. Many of us, we ignore God as well. And we tell him, we start telling God, God, I'm not good enough.
So it's not work.
You tell God, God, I'm not smart enough. If you want wisdom, if you go in the chain, if anyone like wisdom, let him ask of God. You can't do it if you're not studying.
He said we could change it if we need.
Let's deal with this woman. Can Christians really do all things?
That's what it changes.
Okay. This is so what we got for that. Can Christians do all things?
With the original password.
We can when we realize our strength and abilities is rooted not in ourselves, but in God.
Oh, the network security.
When we say we can do all things, we're really saying there is absolutely no limit to what God can accomplish through us when we trust in his power and grace.
So
what I'm saying,
the security key that was in there.
If we ought to make
network security key. Okay.
This Sunday a no excuse Sunday. We ought to start looking at ourselves and saying, God, I'm gonna start doing what you require us to do. You know, when Sunday morning comes, and if you get up all Saturday night and stayed up too late, I'm gonna ask the husbands to get some eye drops and keep them at the front door. Well, if your eyes get a little tired, you can put some of that eye drop up in there. Are you with me, church? You see, if the seats start getting a little hard, we gonna get them cushion seats. You know when we don't come to church and we go to these games and you sit on the little cushion seats? If these get a little bit hard, we're gonna get something for you to cushion yourself on. I'm gonna start working with these deacons and ask these deacons to show up on Sunday morning. Sure, the Bible's done. The same thing ought to be done on the usher board. The same thing in the choir. The president ought to ask them to show up. No excuses that we have. Let me say this, girl. I'm almost ready to go. I think the biggest excuse for us today is to blame. You recall the first sin which happened in the Garden of Eden. God found Adam and Eve. They were hiding because they ate of the forbidden tree. God now calls out Adam. And Adam, he said, where are you? He asked, I heard you in the garden. And I was afraid because I was naked. And so I hid. And God said, help. You eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat of? Adam said, stay with me, church. The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit. And when she gave me that fruit, I did eat. Are you with me? And then first Adam, he began to blame God. He said, God, I didn't ask for her. He said, I took a nap, and when I woke up, my side was hurt. I looked up, and there she was. And seven, Adam blames Eve. Eve came in to eat. Blame is the oldest game that's been around since the beginning. And you see, not much have changed because we simply always want to blame somebody else. Are you with me? You see, we still want to blame others for our mistakes, shortcomings, and sins. You see, we all have excuses as to why we didn't do this or that. But have you got? Sometimes we be late for church, we always want to put it on somebody else, and we got two or three calls. We always have excuses for nothing, for not doing this or that. The funny thing is that we always want to try to blame somebody else. You see, Adam, he tried to pull the wool over God. I heard Brother Stephen saying that we can try to fool us anytime, but you can't fool God no time. You see, he wanted to place all the blame on Eve for why he was disobedient to God. What are you going to do, church? This is me crying. This is me crying out to Saint John. What are you going to do when you have to face God for yourself? You can't put it on a preacher. You can't put it on a pastor. You can't put it on your husband or your wife. You can't put it on your children. What are you going to do when you have to face him for yourself? Amen. Eve didn't take the blame. Adam didn't take the blame. She said, oh no. It wasn't my fault. See, here go the blame again. It was a serpent. Did y'all hear me? Nobody want to take the blame. You see, whenever we fall short of living the life of God that God desires of us, we have a but. That's the why we are not. I'm going to give you all this scripture. I'm trying to get out of here. Turn your Bible real fast. Turn your Bible to 1 Corinthians 10 and 13. Are we now? 1 Corinthians 10 and 13 says, there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man, but God is faithful. Y'all see that?
Yeah.
Who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. God's word is telling us that he'll provide. If we are tempted to do wrong and then we act on it, it's not the devil who made us do it. It is us. We ought to stop talking about the devil made us do it. I'm just being honest. James 1 and 14 said, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away from his own lust and enticed. It's because of us and no one else that we give in. It's because we skip church. I'm just telling us the truth. We stop praying. Skip church. Stop praying. No longer read the gospel. These things, those things that can separate you from God. It's because of us that we don't serve, don't get involved, and never commit ourselves to God. When we use books, I'm going to help us with that if you listen. When we use books, we are telling God a few things. We are telling him he is wrong, and we are telling him no. We are telling him that we do not have faith in him. Y'all catch that? We are telling him that we do not believe. We are telling him that we are too weak and just not that strong. But I come to tell you this morning, oh, my brothers and sisters, God never calls us to do something that we can't. He expects us to be obedient and not have any buts about it. You see, when we praise God, God gets the glory. And when we praise him, we get the blessings. And eventually, that's what I'm trying to tell us this morning. And I come to share with you something. When man says no, but God says yes. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ. The world says no, but God says yes. The world says I can't, but God says you can. The world says stop, but God says go. The world says don't, but God says do. The world says you're defeated, but God says I give you the victory. Am I right about it? I gotta get out of here, but I remember my grandmama used to always tell me. She used to tell me, my God will supply all of your needs. Can I get a witness and she used to keep telling me, Lewis, you better learn how to trust in the Lord. Am I right about it? And when I came here right at this church, am I right about it? My pastor, he would always preach that if thou will confess with the mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, that thou shalt be saved. Am I right about it? And he kept on preaching, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto thee. Am I right about it? And I found out that Sunday morning, I found out that I was on my way to hell. Am I right about it? I got up, church, and I confessed that I was a sinner. Am I right about it? And I accepted Christ as my Savior. Am I right about it? And what I'm trying to say is, one of these sweet days, you're going to be able to meet Jesus. Am I right about it? And you need to make sure that your name is written in the book of life. Am I right about it? You need to make sure that you put your hands in the hands of the Lord. Am I right about it? When you put your hands in the hands of the Lord, he'll take those bucks and give you power. He'll take those bucks and he'll make you get up and start walking with the Lord. Am I right about it? When you put those bucks in his hand, he will give you the power to hold on and serve him. Am I right about it? Somebody said the other day, weeping may endure for a night, but joy, it comes in the morning. Anybody here for the joy that you used to have? I'm speaking of a joy. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Over 2,000 years ago, God gave Jesus to redeem us from our sins. We was on our way to hell. But God gave his son. He came down here. They nailed our Savior to the old rugged cross. He didn't say nothing. He didn't say a word. He stood and hung up there until he gave up the Holy Ghost. They took him down. They buried him in somebody else's tomb. He lay there. But he lay there Friday night. He lay there all Saturday night. But early that Sunday morning, he got up with all power. Power to save me. Power to save you. Power to give us whatever we want. We pray, but sometimes we forget what God is doing for us. Powers, they get in the plane. They fly you from here to California, half drunk. Most of them is drunk. God bless us to be able to land. And we get in the plane. We all know we get in the plane. And if you look on the TV, you find out half of them are always drunk. I'm just telling you the truth. Doctors be drunk. People don't do what they should be doing. It's all because of God. Let us not forget God. I'm say this, and I'm holding the doors. Don't forget God. Sometimes, I'm telling you, sometimes we get older, we don't feel like getting up. I'm just telling the truth. We don't feel like getting up like we should be. Because it is times in my life. It's times in my life when I want to get up. I didn't feel like getting up. My body wouldn't let me get up. But it was by his grace and his mercy that I got up. So what I'm trying to tell us, when we start getting a little older, we start getting a little old in our life, we don't want to do things for God that we should be doing. But think about this. Think about this. If you don't listen to nothing else I said this morning, think about this. Who woke you up this morning? Who started you on your way? Sometimes we don't feel good. Sometimes we don't feel good. I be sick. I have just as much pain in my body than all of us in here. I can't walk right. I can't talk right. And let me tell you something. I am here to hold on to the end. I'm here to hold on to the end. And if I can tell y'all this here, and I'm getting ready to go. I had three strokes since I've been here. I had a heart attack. And God bless me. Sometimes things don't come out of my mouth like they should do. And sometimes I struggle with it. But I'm not stopping. I'm not stopping. I'm gonna hold on to God stopping. And when God stops me, then I'm stopped. Stay at home. Stay at home if you want. Stay at home if you want to and watch to see what God does with church open. Stay at home if you want to. And see what God said, okay, Brother Marcola, stay at home. I'm just going to take him on out of here. He could. And he can. Because he give his life and he take his life away. But don't rush him. The doors of the church. You see?
Serving the Lord, it'll pay off. Every day.
Lord, thou would confess with thy mouth, Lord Jesus, and believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. With everyone that's mourning while the blood is running warm in your veins. Servant of all, will pay after what? While they're making up their mind that maybe someone here who's been making excuses and your butt's a bad thing. You know who you are. I would, but I've done it, but right. God is waiting on you to come back. There's no but with God. The doors are standing open right now. Excuses are just like birthdays. Everybody got one. What have you won this morning? I said birthday. Give her strength. She already knows.
She already knows that you're God that have power and can do all things. So just let your will be done.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you and we love you.
Yes.
And all of the names on the sick list, we pray. Tomorrow we thank God for blessing her in a mighty special way. And then God, we pray that you can bless Brother Matlock in a mighty special way.
Yes, Lord.
And then God, we pray in the name of Jesus. When we leave here, but never from your presence.
Yes, Lord.
That you just watch over each and every one of us in a mighty special way. Protect us.
Yes,
Lord. Danger seen and danger unseen. Because we are approaching the end of time.
Yes, Lord.
And God, we love you.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Would you please repeat these words after me? Much proud.
Much proud.
Much power.
Much power.
Little proud.
Little proud.
Little power.
Little power.
No proud.
No proud.
No power.
No power.
We are dismissed.